Acute aortic syndrome is a life-threatening cardiovascular emergency in which a rapid diagnosis and treatment is paramount. Aortic dissection is the most frequent entity in acute aortic syndrome. The inner layer, the intima of the aorta, tears and blood surges through the tear, creating a new false channel, the false lumen, and separating the middle layer from the outer layer of the aorta, the adventitia, by a flap. The major risk factors are genetic connective tissue disorders, arterial hypertension, and atherosclerosis. Intramural hematoma is another entity in acute aortic syndrome defined as the presence of blood within the aortic wall without intimal disruption or an identifiable entry tear on imaging. Intramural hematoma is a consequence of the rupture of the vasa vasorum, a very small vessel in the aortic wall, and this vasa vasorum in the medial layer presented an hemorrhage. This hemorrhage leads to a localized or extended hematoma and in some cases may evolve to aortic dissection. Therefore, a typical dissection is defined by the presence of a flap and two lumens, the true and false lumens. An intramural hematoma is a semilunar or circular thickening of the aortic wall secondary to vasa vasorum bleeding. Penetrating aortic ulcer is the third entity, which is defined as the ulceration of an aortic atherosclerotic plaque penetrating through the internal elastic lamina into the media. Penetrating aortic ulcer also has the risk of aortic rupture. Aortic dissection implies around 70% of acute aortic syndrome. Intramural hematoma, the 15%, and finally the penetrating aortic ulcer, 5%. There are several classifications of acute aortic syndrome, depending on the involvement of the ascending aorta. In the Stanford classification, type A is defined when the ascending aorta is involved, and type B when the ascending aorta is not involved. In the Beckey classification, type 1 is defined when the ascending and descending aorta are dissected. Type 2, when only the ascending aorta is dissected. And type 3 is when only the descending aorta is involved. The estimated rate of acute aortic syndrome is 15 out of 100,000 people per year. In comparison to other cardiovascular emergencies presented with chest pain, acute aortic syndrome is more frequent than pulmonary embolism, but significantly less frequent than acute coronary syndrome, such as myocardial infarction. Therefore, one acute aortic syndrome is diagnosed per 80 acute coronary syndrome cases. However, non-diagnosed acute aortic syndrome has a very high mortality rate, being 25% in the first 24 hours and 70% in the first 2 weeks. Therefore, early diagnosis and treatment are crucial to decrease acute aortic syndrome mortality. Clinical data is useful to assess the prior probability of acute aortic syndrome. European Society of Cardiology guidelines propose a risk assessment tool based on three groups of information: predisposing conditions, pain features, and clinical examination, and propose a scoring system that considered the number of this group that were involved, from 0 to 3, the presence of 0, 1, 2 or 3 groups of information is associated with increasing pretest probability, which should be taken into account in the diagnostic approach of all acute aortic syndromes. Imaging techniques play a pivotal role in the diagnosis of acute aortic syndrome. Computed tomography is the most commonly used imaging modality owing to its wide availability, accuracy, and large field of view. Computed tomography plus transthoracic echocardiography is the best combination for diagnosis of acute aortic syndrome and its complications, and allows important morphologic and dynamic aspects of acute aortic syndrome to be assessed by appropriately managed disease. Ideally, transesophageal echocardiography should be performed in patients with hemodynamic instability or when the diagnosis is not defined. The best role of transesophageal echocardiography is immediately before surgery or during endovascular treatment in the operating suture and under general anesthesia. Magnetic resonance imaging may offer complementary information, mainly in the subacute phase. Surgery is the treatment of choice in ascending aorta dissection. Surgery reduces 1 month mortality from 90% to 30%. The advantage of surgery over conservative therapy is particularly obvious in the long-term follow-up. Despite improvement in surgical and anesthetic techniques, a perioperative mortality, 25%, remains high, mainly due to delay in surgical treatment or presence of severe complications. There are different surgical treatments depending on the proximal extension of the dissection. Ascending aorta replacement by a tubular graft is the most frequently used. However, in patients with genetic disorders, more extended resection is recommended. Medical treatment with beta blockers is the most frequent management in non-complicated descending aorta dissection, the type B. However, in cases with acute complications, particularly signs of impending aortic rupture, peripheral or visceral ischemia, or hemodynamic instability, surgical or endovascular treatment should be indicated. In patients with genetic disorders, endovascular treatment may be considered as a bridge to open surgery. This figure shows the changes in medical and surgical treatment in type A aortic dissection in the International Registry of Aortic Dissection. The yellow line defines the mortality rate. As you can see, the mortality decreased throughout the years from 30 to 20%. In type B dissection, we can see the increase of endovascular treatment over these 20 years, the green columns. However, the mortality has not changed significantly. Aortic dissection was described many years ago. It is clear that in recent decades, much progress has been made in diagnostic and therapeutic techniques. However, mortality remains high, and preventive medical and surgical treatment is required to reduce the risk of these severe conditions. Thank you for your attention.